Why do you call me at this time?
You promised us a painless death if we give ourselves up. Come and get us.
You can wait. Call me again at another time.
Welcome to the Hormonal Werewolves. I'm Canadian boy Ryan, and with me as always is Abby Road Rage.
Hey guys.
And Adam still don't got no nickname.
No. We'll put that to the poll. We'll let the werewolf groupies decide what my eventual nickname is.
I would like a werewolf groupie. Cool. I'm kind of excited for tonight, guys. Let's be honest.
It's gonna be a good night. Mm-hmm. We are the only YouTube show that talks about movies new and old, good and bad, everything in between, and is only 33% Canadian. I add that because I think that's the only thing that separates us.
From everybody.
There are literally no other YouTube channels that
none.
Do. This is none. And don't bother searching. Just take my word.
No, don't look. Just there take our word. None. You're hearing it on the internet.
Congratulations. You found the only one you can stop
the
now.
The only one. We will scratch that itch.
Yeah. We'll scratch any itch.
Yeah.
Join our Patreon, we'll scratch even more.
They're very limber.
Tonight's movie is but before I get into that, sorry. So we are doing spooky season picks. We got a couple of movies lined up. We also have another top 10 list coming out. But tonight is a pretty substantial Halloween-y movie, I would say. It's mm-hmm. basically become almost the standard. I don't know how it managed that, but it has. I'm of course talking about 2007's Trick or Treat.
Don't forget your costume.
All sorts of things. Roam free.
The Halloween School Bus Massacre.
Daddy!
Be quiet.
Why?
You'll bother the neighbors.
Okay.
There's another tradition. Always check your candy.
I hate Halloween.
Trick or treat.
Not trick or treat. Not trick or treats. Trick or trick. Trick or trick or treat. I don't know.
Depending on how you spell or in your Google search, you will get a drastically different movie or movie.
Very, very true. This is like the Toys R Us, but
yes,
right. A good way to do it. Yeah, perfect. Directed by Michael Dougherty. Adam and I know him quite well because I think he directed our favorite Godzilla film.
Mm-hmm. I'm a fan of everything that this guy
and Krampus.
Yeah, Krampus. This dude has nailed everything he's done and starring a whole bunch of peoples. We got Anna Paquin. Oh my God, I couldn't remember his name. Brian Cox.
I love him.
Brian Cox. Dylan Baker.
Dylan Baker.
That annoying kid from Bad Santa.
Yeah. Herman Merman.
Dylan Baker does not get enough credit. I would just like to put that out there right now.
He's one of those guys that you see in a movie and it's like, oh, it's that guy. You don't know, like, nobody knows Dylan Baker.
I know him from Delirium with John Candy back in the day, where he's like, thinks he's on a soap opera set. And Sam the wife Raimi. Is slowly poisoning Dylan Baker. So, like, every time, and John Candy's character knows it, and every time he sees, like, his gums are bleeding, his hair is falling out, he just gets weirder and weirder.
Jesus.
Funniest shit ever. But yeah, there's a lot of faces in here that we recognize. Even if you don't know where you know them from.
Sorry, I was going to say, what were you going to say?
No, it's all right. No, it was just an aside. I was just going to say, had Sam Raimi been able to continue to make his Spider-Man movies, he would have been the Lizard, because he was actually the human character that was the doctor. And I think, that was pretty cool casting. I think he would have knocked that out of the park.
He had a Billy Dee Williams situation where he never got to live the full potential of the character.
Right.
Sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off. I just noticed Adam.
No, you're all good. I was just saying, like, there's a lot of these. It's one of those movies where you see all these people and you're like, I know it's that guy that's in that thing with that girl. And, you know.
But yeah, this is like horror convention, the movie. Like all the people that are C and B listeners.
I was gonna say, Abby has 90% of these people autographs.
Right. Yeah. Abby, I'm sure she's met all of them.
What?
And eaten all, breadsticks with them at all.
I love a good anthology, though. Like, that's my bread and butter. I think I really just enjoy it, especially when they all intertwine so deliciously, like they do in this movie.
Not too many movies do that, though. I mean, I'm hard-pressed to think of another one that does it, at Pulp least Fiction? To this extent.
It is the Pulp Fiction. I actually have that. Yeah, it's the Pulp Fiction of horror anthology.
Yeah.
I
mean, usually there's an anthology movie.
Usually there's like a wraparound that connects all the stories together.
Yeah, the beginning and the end, but this intertwines.
This actually has stories that intersect each other, which
and
is like
each
really
character
cool.
Sees the other characters at different parts in different parts of the story. So you actually pay. I apologize, my cats are insane. It's pieced together in such a great way that if you were to kind of pull apart the pieces to put it in actual timeline order, it would be a very different movie. But I dig it a lot. I really, really do.
This movie kind of jumps all over the place too. So I don't even like to even just go by like segment by segment, we'll kind of be doing the movie an injustice because the segments themselves don't really go segment by segment.
That's what I mean.
Like we're starting off with, we start off with the couple, but we even get like clues to the, Brian Cox segment pretty early on right here. So I don't know how we are even going to attempt to do this one. I guess
we'll
just do our favorite.
We just sort of touch on each of the segments and maybe mention the cool ways in which they intertwine. Like to start, we know the opening scene is the girl and her boyfriend that come home, or husband, I don't know, I guess husband, come home from the Halloween party. He's drunk. He wants to get a little action. She just wants to take the decorations down. There are certain rules of Halloween.
You don't... Jesus Christ, you don't know the rules?
You don't take the decorations down before the night is over. You don't blow out the candles. Everybody's got to get there. These are things. These are very important rituals. And she learns quickly that, you know, that's probably a bad idea. She insists on blowing out the candles and, you know, closing up the pumpkins and taking down the decorations. And she broke a rule.
I like how she's not interested in Halloween at all, but her robot costume is fucking
pretty badass.
A banger. That was a kick-ass robot costume. And then she's got to be like the stick in the mud, like, oh, Halloween's stupid. It's for little kids. You're just going to play video games all day, you know?
Well, actually, she gave him permission to put the tape on and she would meet him
the
in
tape,
there. So.
Right.
The tape.
Go inside, put on the tape.
The tape on. So you literally...
Well, I was just like, what if the tape wasn't even a porno? I mean, we see that it is.
It's a sexy tape, you know it is.
But what if it was like, you know, like instructions on how to repair your VCR or something? Like it would
then their sex life really sucked.
Totally different. Put the tape on. You know,
you saw how happy he got.
This movie, I have a couple, like this. There are a couple scenes. It's this one in the werewolf orgy,
mm-hmm.
where I almost wish they weren't in the movie, because otherwise this could have been almost like a family horror movie. What do we call it? Gateway horror, mm-hmm. that like everyone could watch. Like, you know,
yeah, like, throwing the sex in there makes it like the violence.
Like the 2 seconds of the woman riding the guy cowgirl. Like, why do we need that?
We see a decapitated child's head at one point, too, though.
I mean, yeah. And the little one helped me with the eyes, Daddy. But again, I see what Adam's saying. It's a lot more comfortable to explain horror to people and show them that it's fake than to see naked
people. I mean, I guess that's a very American thing. Like,
yeah.
You know, get the sex out of there, but we're okay with the violence. But, exactly. You know, the violence is pretty subdued for the most part.
Surprise, motherfucker.
I do love the imagery of when the husband finds the wife when he goes looking for her, mm-hmm. with the giant lollipop shoved in the mouth. I think that's just a fantastic little image.
Yeah.
We get that amazing opening credits.
Amazing opening credits, which is like basically mainlining Halloween nostalgia, like in my veins. Like the music, the tone, you know, it's just atmosphere. An amazing sequence.
Yeah.
And the hand-drawn images kind of harken back to, it reminds me of like Night of the Demons.
Well, it reminds me of Creepshow. Like, you know, yes, Creepshow's all flipping through the comic books.
Because it jumps into comic book.
Yeah.
It's a much better comparison. Yeah. That's probably what they were going for, too.
The fuck is a creep show?
I do like, very briefly, the guy, while she's out taking down the decorations, there's the guy, I call him the red herring, the guy in the mask that you think is
the best.
But yeah, then it's just some kid standing there being creepy.
He's our Tommy Doyle.
Well, that's Dylan Baker.
Well, but it wasn't, because you think it is, but he takes the mask off and gets in a car. He's a kid. He's like
That's right. So we do get into the like after the that first quote unquote segment, we do get our first real segment, and that's the one with Dylan Baker and the Charlie Brown's an asshole kid, which is probably the funniest line in this movie.
Go watch Charlie Brown, and I'll be in a minute.
Charlie Brown's an asshole.
Billy Wilkins, language.
This one was probably the weakest for me. It was fine. It was creepy and silly, but it was so subdued. Like, compared with the way the rest of this movie goes.
Yeah.
This one was really subdued. This was just I don't even know if it needs to be part of this movie.
Well, I think it was more the fear for this child You know, watching the principal kill some rotten kid is kind of funny. And then the kid screaming out the window, "Dad, are you gonna help me?" Like, there's just something so absurd. And he's trying to, because he's dug a giant hole in his backyard. I do like when the kids come, and this is part of the intertwining, the kids from the next segment come trick-or-treating, and he is just standing there covered in blood, like, you know, hey, great costume, because he's the school principal, Mr. Wilkins, you know?
Mm-hmm. It was pretty, you know, go ahead, Ryan. Sorry.
No, I was going to say, if anything, this story kind of just feels like an excuse to show us all the other stories we're going to get. Because we get the kids, we get Brian Cox, we get...
I like that they started small. Because they go pretty big in the other ones.
Also, it helps to not feel sympathy for him later when he meets a certain fate. You it know, he just killed a child. He's character. Torturing his own child, you know, not torturing, but bringing up in quite a sadistic way. And you know.
But again, I feel he does enough in that particular, like we're talking about the werewolf segment. I feel he does enough in that segment to make himself a douche canoe. That we didn't need this as well.
Yeah.
Well, I did like that how there's the callback scene between him and Brian Cox.
Yes, in the window.
And and if for no other reason than that, I think that this scene should exist. Because I really enjoy that little you're seeing, like, you know, at first you see what's going on over there, and now you see what's going on in the other house. Because in this scene, you see Brian Cox's character being attacked by something. Damn, you don't know what.
Yeah, you don't know yet.
And I think that's pretty rewarding. That's a really rewarding kind of mini wraparound to find out that was actually, you know, Sam, the star of the show, so to speak.
Screw you.
Help me! Wilkins!
You know, I like that. The kid, his son, the principal's son, does bring the annoying factor up to the point where you're kind of hoping he gets killed a little bit.
Yeah.
But you know, and I'll be honest with you, like, I'm pretty good at spotting, like, you know, the red herring, and this isn't gonna, the first time I watched this, when that knife comes down, I thought for sure it was his kid.
Let's curve a scary face this time.
And then it is kind of funny when he's trying to bury him and the kid wakes up and he's like stabbing him to death with a shovel.
Well, I'm just like, what did I say? I said, it's pretty brutal, considering it's a kid fighting for his life.
I know. And you don't usually
see laying in a hole.
And we're laughing about
in a movie produced by Bryan Singer.
Yeah.
Womp womp.
Womp womp. I do like, though, when the trick-or-treaters come and he's all covered in blood, Sam gets his candy. Because that saved Mr. Wilkins at that point. Because if he had not given Sam his candy,
Sam would have Sam would have killed Mr. Wilkins.
So
Sam shows up trick-or-treating with the kids. He's right behind him.
And when the kids walk away, the kids that, you know, go find the other one in the next segment, there's little Sam with his little, and he goes, "Did you get one?" And he hands him that thing and he takes his candy and he just turns and walks away.
I kind of like that. Sam's just this character. Well, I have some questions about that, but I'll save it until we get to the last segment or whenever we start talking about that more.
Yeah.
But like he's about the rituals first and foremost.
Yes, the rules of Halloween.
There are certain rules that one must abide by.
Follow the rules and you'll be fine.
What you've done and in your life or crimes. Like he's not really there for retribution about any of that shit. Just pay this.
No, what's his name? The neighbor learns that. The only thing that saved him was the chocolate bar at the end. He takes it out of his pocket. which means he completed the ritual of giving Sam candy, and Sam leaves him alone.
Right, because that was actually a question of mine, because I was I always wondered, like, did he not kill him because he just accidentally gave him candy, or did he not kill him because he knew the little ghost kids were showing up?
No, he followed the rules. Little ghost kids were just completely bad luck on his part.
Yeah, that was just kind of one of those. In my mind,
but he followed the rules, and Sam walked away.
That was one of those worst night ever scenarios. Like, if it hadn't been for the fact that he had murdered those kids, he would have been fine after the Sam incident.
Yep.
It just so happens that the ghost showed up.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, by the way, this is happening too.
Man, that sucks.
Yeah, exactly.
Bad night for that guy.
Worst night ever.
Trick or treat.
Jeez.
And then those same little trick or treaters begin our next segment, where we learn about the Halloween school bus massacre.
I don't know if this is a hot take or not, but this is actually my favorite segment of the movie.
I don't think it's a hot take at all.
I think it's really creepy. I think it's the creepiest one. This one is like legit actually scary.
There's something about the old fashioned trick or treat masks and things like that.
Yeah.
That are eerie. Like when you see those pictures, and you know, it just, it gives me the excitement of Halloween. So yes, this is a very eerie, creepy, but I guess the gist of it is, well, you got these group of, you know, tweeners or teenagers that are collecting jack-o'-lanterns they run into, or they go to Rhonda's house, and Rhonda is like devout Halloween traditionalist. Like, you know, this is the deal.
I think she's on the spectrum too.
Yeah, she's on the spectrum for sure.
Yes, 100%. And basically,
I gotta say, they treat every kid on the spectrum in this movie like Rain Man.
Number 18 in 1988. Squeezed and pulled and hurt my neck in 1988.
With pumpkins.
Like, even the kids on the bus are like, wrong way. You know, boxer shorts, Cincinnati. Like, everyone has the same sort of quirky stuff going on.
It's not handled great. It's not handled fantastically.
Yeah.
I mean, it was 2007, so I mean, at least it wasn't like the Predator.
It was like a week ago. It was like 2 decades ago.
Does anybody else think the parents in this neighborhood just like really let loose every now and again? Like, what was they go to the one lady's house?
This is like a swinger's house. Well, that's actually my favorite scene in the movie.
Wow.
It's Mrs. Henderson's house.
Mrs. Henderson's house.
And they ring the doorbell.
And Coach Whatever has a hot dog bent over.
She's trying to get the kids drunk. Like, that's the first thing. Like, she's like, do you want to drink?
And then the face she makes when they say no.
She's disgusted. She's disgusted that they won't take a drink. Yep. And then there's like a furry orgy going on in the background.
And that was like their gym teacher or something, their coach.
Yeah, well, that's like, and my best, the little chunky kid goes, is like, Coach Taylor in a hot dog costume. I'm fucking a pig.
I don't even know what that was. Coach Taylor was in a hot dog costume. But fucking a pig, I think.
The Halloween parade that they keep cutting to is the most amazing thing. The most amazing Halloween party I've ever seen. with a marching band and like.
It felt very Mardi Gras.
People on stilts and like. It's the Halloween party of my dreams.
This whole movie is Halloween as fuck.
I love it.
Even the color scheme, like right down to it, like it's just a bunch of blacks and oranges and browns.
The town is the town I want to live in. Like, it's just, I want a town that really goes out for Halloween.
I know we've already passed it, but the visual, like right when they're telling about the school bus massacre, and when they're telling it, like the screen like fades into this really muted orange, like Halloween orange. You just see like a leaf falling like down. It's the most Halloween fall thing I've ever seen in film. And it's why this movie, like in such a short time, has propelled itself into being like a must watch this time of year. It's a must watch. Like between this and Halloween 1978. Like those are the two movies you must watch this time of year. And you know, this wasn't made that long ago.
Yeah, I have a few that are on my list every year that I watch.
Yeah.
And this is definitely one of them. Halloween is definitely one of them. Tales of Halloween is one. Again, I like anthologies.
Me too.
We got a Brian Cox versus midget in a burlap.
Not a midget.
He's a tiny little guy.
He is a tiny little guy.
I mean, he looks like Pumpkinhead's kid, right? Even when they finally reveal him, he kind of looks like, you know, when you unbury Pumpkinhead, that little kid that's in the ground.
That's what I want to touch on really quick. I wish we never saw what he looked like
underneath the.
I don't like it.
Okay. Really? I like it. How he's just like a little jack-o'-lantern guy. I wanted him to put
that thing back on afterwards, though.
I like it.
I
thought he looked great. He looked like a fucking boglin. He looked like he looked like the jack-o'-lantern boglin.
I did.
That's 10 out of 10 creature design. Yes.
I got the one right back there. Yeah.
Go get it.
The jack-o'-lantern boglin. Jesus Christ. So,
a little Quinn Lord plays Sam. How old was he when he did this? So it was not a little person. It was actually just a young person.
I actually love that.
Yeah, me too.
God, dude, that is totally Sam. Look at that.
Jack-o'-lantern boglin got it for $7 because they couldn't sell them, so they were giving away a clearance.
That's awesome.
This is my favorite segment, and I think that is a hot take. I don't think this is a lot of people's favorite segment. I think a lot of people see it as a satisfying conclusion, but not necessarily. I love actually seeing Sam get his hands dirty and learning more about him. The most interesting thing about this whole movie is Sam to me. And I love actually seeing him get his hands dirty at the end here. I think the design of Sam is fantastic. That scene where, like, you know, they're chasing each other around the house and they finally get to his bedroom and there's all the, what's it say on his wall?
There's just a bunch of,
shoot. What does it say on his wall?
I'm looking to see if I wrote it down. It just says, like scrawled with Halloween and Samhain greetings. So it's probably just
like Samhain and stuff like that. Right.
Samhain. It means the Lord of the Dead. The end of summer. The festival of Samhain.
What did he say?
You know that clip from Halloween. You know that clip from Halloween 2 is going in here right now. I do enjoy this segment. Don't get me wrong. I absolutely think it's fantastic. The only thing, though, and this, I mentioned the other one is my favorite. This one.
Brian Cox,
Brian Cox is fantastic, but this one makes me wish we had a Sam movie, and the fact that we don't, I feel sours me on this segment.
I think
Sam could carry a whole movie.
I think just he's so good because of the mystery and speculating. I think this is the perfect amount of Sam, in my opinion. Abby,
I am agreeing with you. I feel like too much. I love Sam. I love his visual. I love the little character. I love his little stockinged feet. He's so cute. But I agree. I think too much. I don't know. I mean, he did really well in this, but I'm just not sure of like a whole backstory. I like that he's just kind of the spirit of Halloween.
Yeah, I like the mystery. I mean, they're essentially trying to make the Santa. This is the they're trying to make him the Santa Claus of Halloween. That's what they're. Mm-hmm. Attempting to do, and they almost succeeded.
Close.
I don't know. I disagree. I think, like, you see that, like, what's that movie with what's her name from Lord of the Rings and Scott Speedman?
Liv Tyler.
The Strangers.
Yeah, The Strangers. Like, what if you got like a Strangers set up with Sam and a bunch of Jehovah's Witnesses? Like, they're not going to give him candy no matter what. So it's like Sam trying to break into their house. That's and hysterical. He starts killing them one by one. I'd watch the show.
Like,
would he have minions like in Krampus? Like, would he have, or just him?
I think it'd be just him.
Okay. I'm willing to give it a shot, my friend.
Well, I mean, my whole thing is I don't understand why we don't have at least three movies in this franchise already. Like, with each one telling you a little bit more about Sam. Like, and it's criminal that we don't.
Yeah.
We should have at least three trick-or-treats by this point. If we can have 20,000 saws and 12 screams, can we at least do two more trick-or-treats?
I agree. Just one. Like, who do we have to talk to?
I feel Michael Dougherty is just cursed, though. Like,
yeah, you said after the Godzilla thing, it really shit all over him.
Well,
we're going to have to kidnap somebody Christmas Vacation style, like the boss.
Yeah, yeah, someone. I'd say we kidnap Bryan Singer, but he'd probably get excited about that.
la, la, la.
You haven't heard of his name in a while, have we?
No.
No, I wonder why.
he's never been charged with anything. Like, he's still walking around.
Well, that's Hollywood. But I do want to say, you mentioned the pumpkins with what's her name in the school bus segment.
Lollipop. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
When Brian Cox opens the door with that shotgun and there's like 100 pumpkins in his yard. That scene is so great. It just does the quick zoom out and it shows like everything in his yard. I love that. And that's why I think Sam could have his own movie. Give me more of that shit.
Or at least like a Halloween special. Like, even if you just did one of those like half hour Halloween specials or something.
I think actually Sam is in a half hour Halloween special. I think it's animated.
But it's cartoon.
He's in animation. Yeah. I mean, I think that eventually that was the plan, like to make the series more about. This was like the introduction, and every movie they were going to like give you a little bit more. But like this movie was made, wait, we haven't even talked about this movie was made in 2007, released in 2009. It sat on a shelf for 2 years.
I don't get it.
Nobody believed in it.
Yeah.
Did not get a wide release. It got a theatrical release in like three or four cities. It is kind of like sporadically. And then came out on DVD, Blu-ray, and was like this massive hit. Just from like word of mouth and people buying it and shit like that. And it's like...
Well, there's hope for us,
But no, it's not. There is no hope.
No, I meant for our show.
Oh, okay. That's fair. Yeah.
2 years from now.
Woohoo!
But like, there's no hope. If we were going to get a trick or treat sequel, we would have got it by now. All right, we're jumping into the rating space. Adam, you want
to
go first?
Are you about to puke? Are you okay? What's the matter?
No, I was thinking. I was my deep in thought.
Oh,
no, I'm good.
That's what that face was.
That was my deep in thought face.
Who wants to go first?
I'm going.
Go for it.
Okay. This movie ascended to one of my absolute must-watch movies around Halloween in such a short amount of time. I mean, it's really crazy when you think about how this movie hasn't really even been out there for that long, and yet it has such a presence around Halloween. I guarantee you that this movie is in a lot of people's Halloween traditions, and I probably can't say that about many movies made in the last 30 or 40 years.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like a lot of people just watch movies, horror movies in general, regardless of genre, around this year, but everybody picks 1, 2, 3 that all right, I have to watch this, and this has become one of those movies in a really short amount of time for a lot of people, including myself. It's one of the best anthology horror movies I've ever seen. It's one of the best pure Halloween movies I've ever seen. Michael Dougherty, in my eyes, can do no wrong. I love that guy. I hope to God he makes another movie one day. Regardless of genre, I will be there in the theater when that movie comes out. I can't give this anything less than a 5 out of 5. I love this movie. I am a worshiper of Halloween. I bow down at the altar. And this movie, I think, does... it's the best representation of just pure, unadulterated love for the holiday. So I'm going to go 5 out of 5. You know, scenes where like the wife asked the guy to go grab the tape that is a little hotter than it should be. Out of 5.
5.
Go inside, put on the tape.
You ever watch porn with like somebody else and it can go either. It's hit or miss. It can go, say, that's it can a be good, a lot yeah, of fun can, or it can be
that's pretty good. Kind of that's a train wreck. Yeah, it can go either way. That's good.
So
we used to play this game where we would just fast forward it and whatever was on the scene, we would do. Like at whatever stage.
So you ate a lot of pizza and got stuck in washing machines and never mind.
Exactly.
So I love this movie. I have loved it from the first day I saw it. I watch it every year. I agree with Adam on a lot of points. There is, it's unusual for a movie made less than 20 years ago to have such a nostalgia that I love when I get a new movie that becomes part of my repertoire, must be repeated yearly. And I also agree that I will give this 5 out of 5 creepy children masks on a bus that freak me out to no end. Those masks scary. Out of 5.
Wrong way. Wrong way.
And it's brilliant, and I think everyone should watch it. What do you got,
Ryan? I'm going to make you guys mad again. So I agree with Adam. Michael Dougherty is a treasure. And the fact that he is just not getting to make movies is the biggest frustration. One of the biggest frustrations I have as a film lover.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not as big of a fan of this movie as you guys are. This is my least favorite Michael Dougherty movie. It's still a good movie, though. And it captures Halloween so well. I can't get over the fact that I don't like that opening. I don't like the first one, like with the principal and his son. I could take it or leave it. I feel the whole werewolf vampire thing is just filler and rushed. But, I mean, that creepy kid sequence, the very opening is great. And Sam is fantastic. There's some really great things in this movie. This movie does have its problems, like all anthologies do. I have yet to find an anthology movie that just hits it out of the park with every single segment. This one is no different, in my opinion. I'm still giving this a solid 3.5 out of 5, which is a 7 out of 10, which is still really good. Like I said, it's my least favorite Michael Dougherty movie. It's still a good movie. I'm not as big of a fan of it. My family absolutely loves it. Actually, in the episode we're going to release where I talk about family watch-along horror movies,
yeah, I saw that.
It's on my list because...
I knew. I was prepared.
Yeah, because my family is bigger on this movie than I am. But again, 3.5 out of 5, it's still good. We still watch it every year, and it's definitely a lot better than most of the other anthologies out there. And yeah, Michael Dougherty, make someone give him money
and make more movies, Michael. Let him make more movies.
And I want to say something too. Like,
yeah,
art, Sam in this movie is what Art the Clown begs and pleads to be. Like they were so, like all those movies, maybe I'm opening up a can of worms, they're so like, we're trying to make the next horror icon, don't you guys think he's the next horror icon? And like Sam did it effortlessly.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he wasn't overly pushed, he didn't have to do anything
and he had footy so pajamas.
Gross and mean-spirited. And you know, it was just kind of like a natural. He is Spirit Halloween this year. It's either him or Beetlejuice. So
that's fair.
Fuck our.
So yeah, that's a good one though. I'll give that. I'll give it 3.5 out of 5. Sam stabbing a candy bar in the chest out of 5.
That's good.
And guys, if you know the deal, if you want to write to us, you can reach us at hormonalwerewolves@gmail.com. You can find us on Facebook at hormonalwerewolves3. On the YouTube, where hopefully you're subscribed and watching all of our videos. And Instagram, Threads, wherever paperbacks are sold. I don't know. Find us, write to us. I don't know.
That's all I got. Fantastic. I review Amityville movies. That's all I do.
It continues.
Although I got to say, the actual discussion about Amityville movie has narrowed. The episodes remain the same length, but the actual talking about the movie has gotten smaller. There ain't nothing to talk about these fucking movies.
It's just.
But I do it over at Scream Until You Like It. Check it out if you do so feel like it.
And Adam, how about you, sir?
I'm just still trying to make a friend. I'm just trying to build up that pool of friends. And I don't know where I'm going with that. But
thank you for being a friend.
Yeah, you're welcome. when I was a kid, my mom would be cooking. She was absolutely terrified of opening. Do you guys ever have those rolls of Pillsbury Doughboy, the bread tubes?
Oh yeah.
That pop.
And she would be absolutely terrified of, like, you know, the biscuits and the rolls.
As she should.
I had to come in and I'd have to open it for her, and she'd have to like leave the room and anything. So anyway. If you're a complete and utter pussy and that scares you.
And you have a biscuit phobia.
I will come over to your house and open up your biscuit.
Did you just say, I'll come over to your house and pop your biscuit?
I will pop your biscuits.
Write to him at Hormonal Biscuits.
Put sausage gravy all over. No, that won't do it. Hormonal Biscuits at gmail.com.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. Fantastic. Now every I want week. Biscuits.
In case you were wondering where I come from, I'll be giving my kid a bath just thinking about what I'm gonna say. this segment. I'm like, yeah, what am I gonna say this time?
It's behind the scenes into the process. All right, guys. Have a good night.
Everybody's out looking for him, right?
Yeah.
Who do you think he's going to come back to? Back to his lair.
We'll be ready for him.